here so we can monitor that.
Yeah.
There or here?
There's fine.
Move it wherever you want to.
I'm just thinking, how far are you going to walk, David?
This goes behind that pulpit.
Right here.
Oh! I thought you were running away
with our music.
Or
huh?
With our music, they might try to...
Do they boot us off or just... They do?
It'll say, you're playing music.
Not legally.
But and then you have to get back on after the music's done.
Yeah. Push, go ahead.
It's on.
Oh, yeah. The kitten. Hey, there was a kitty.
Right now?
No, last week. It stopped, stood at the door, sat there for like 5 minutes.
Let's speak to David.
Is it okay? Is it okay?
Oh, yeah. It was in the middle of a circle.
Barbara tried to rescue you and said no.
Unless
you traded for the
mean cat. Oh no. She would not do that. It's Jack.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Jack. He wants to cut down those yellow flowers.
Yeah, I missed it. Just go ahead.
Good morning. Thank you all for coming out this morning. We have a small crowd again, but something about a hurricanes kind of got people a little nervous this morning, and I understand that. A lot of our regular people are headed out of town, and that's now they're saying the storm has turned some, and maybe we won't get what it looked like earlier in the week. And that's a good thing. And then some. Some of us is not very smart at all. Some of us still rode a motorcycle this morning. Todd, I'm glad I'm not the only one. It's just going to be me, at least two of us. But
did you ride the pretty orange one?
No, I rode the man's bike, the rare black heart. But we do have a lot of things that we need to think about and take to the Lord this morning. As far as our announcements, of course, it's, you know, the rides, and we always have them posted. And they're on our Facebook page if you want to look, and you can go through and see the announcements. I think some of the rides changed, dates was changed on some of them.
Some of the dates have changed, and September 14th is the full moon ride.
Okay.
Now, I'm going to be out of town that day because I got to do a wedding up in Valdosta, but I'll be back that night. And then there's also another ride that same day, wasn't there?
Mm-hmm. Just was something that popped up.
Yeah, I think a lot of us was out of town during that time too.
Yeah. So I'll be back that night.
Okay.
Right there. It's ride for recovery.
Right.
September the 14th. Okay, and remember our bats. That's in November.
That's in November. And there's also September 28th. There is a ride called the Freedom Ride, which starts at Harley-Davidson in
Seminole.
Yeah, Seminole Harley-Davidson, and goes to Cocoa Beach. Does that sound right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so a lot of rides going on, a lot of things for charity. And, of course, the Oktoberfest is upon us. I mean, it won't be long at all. And that's when we have a lot of people come into town during that time. And Heaven Saints is still planning on being here.
As far as we know.
So they'll be here. So, and they'll be set up downtown and giving out Bibles and talking and praying with people, which is a wonderful thing. Prayer requests this morning. We want to remember there was, what did you say, 7 killed in Texas yesterday. Someone had stole a mail truck. And we're seeing that. It just breaks my heart, you know. We're seeing that every day. It seems like there's someone somewhere else. And, you know, if we read our Bible, though, it talks of that stuff and in the end days. And we definitely, every day that we're here, we're a little closer to that day that the Lord is coming back. And, you know, my prayer is people will look out and see that. And I just looked out the door there and seen it is pouring rain. But Tanya, I will let you ride my man's black Harley home if you want to ride it home.
No.
Any other prayer requests this morning? We don't remember Jim's mom, Mary. She's had her surgery and is
doing good.
That's a blessing.
She was a chatterbox yesterday. It was so cute.
anything else?
I guess everybody in the path of this crazy storm.
Yeah, we need to remember people in this storm, and you know, we do need to take it serious.
The Bahamas are getting. We need to keep those folks in prayer because that's
like 2 days. They're saying it could sit there for 48 hours.
Yeah, I seen somewhere this morning they said it could affect like 70,000 people in that area where it's. And I think they've already evacuated or it's maybe not mandatory, but asking people to leave. So we need to remember them. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we could be in your house again this morning. We thank you for your many blessings upon us, Lord. We ask that you be with those that have been mentioned here, those that are sick. We have a lot of people out, Lord, and we ask that you just watch over them and protect them. Be with those that are in the path of this storm, Lord. Help them to be prepared and help them to be ready. And the greatest thing, Lord, is I pray that they are ready, whatever may happen. That they would spend eternity with you. Lord, we ask that you go with us in all that we do here this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Stand.
clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
I'm
Sometimes my messages come, it can be either I'll dream something or something will just through the middle of the day, and I say, okay, Lord, and I'll jot down it's something that he's you know, wanting me to speak on. And a lot of times it can be things that happens during my day that'll make me think, well, that'd be a good message. I don't know if y'all seen my Facebook post this week of that rattlesnake that we caught in my backyard. And I seen that thing, I said, Lord, I hope that's not a message, because I don't like snakes. I asked Jim if we wanted to have a service for that snake, and he said that if we did, that I could handle that one all by myself. Yeah, I don't like them big rattlesnakes in my yard. And my neighbor, he told me if I ever see one, to let him know. So I go over and I ring his doorbell, and I said, rattlesnake in my backyard. A yard man is holding it with these little thing that he picks up limbs with. And he said, I'll be right there. And he grabs one of those little plastic kitchen garbage cans, no lid or nothing, comes running over with it. He says, just drop it in that garbage can. And I said, you don't have a bucket that you can latch a lid on or something? Oh, no, said, he'll be fine. Put him in there. And then he sets it in his car and drives off to the land with it to take it over there to that place that gets their venom and protects them. not the plans that this old redneck had for that Christmas. I can tell you that. But with this morning, we're going to be in Job, the first chapter. I'm going to read the whole chapter. So bear with me. It says, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. There were born to him 7 sons and 3 daughters. He possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 female donkeys, and very many servants. So that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. His sons used to go and hold a feast in the house of each one on his day. And they would send and invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. And when the days of the feast had run their course, Job would send and consecrate them. And he would rise early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus Job did continually. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. The Lord said to Satan, from where have you come? Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro on the earth and from walking up and down on it. And the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house, that all that he has on every side? You have blessed the works of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your hand. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. Now there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And there came a messenger to Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them. And the Sabaeans fell upon them and took them and struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them. And I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the Chaldeans formed 3 groups and made a raid on the camels and took them and struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was yet speaking, there came another and said, your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And behold, a great wind came across the wilderness and struck the 4 corners of the house, and it fell upon the young people, and they are dead, and I alone have escaped to tell you. Then Job arose and tore his robe, shaved his head, and fell on the ground and worshipped. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. Lord, we pray that each one of us, Lord, will receive something from you this morning as we study and talk about your word. Heavenly Father, we ask that you just protect those that are in the path of this storm, that you'll protect all those that we've mentioned this morning, and just be with us. Most of all, Lord, we ask that you help us to worship you this morning and that you give us something that we can take away from here today, Lord, that we can say truly we have been in the house of the Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I guess if I had a title this morning of this message, it would be God's Servant Job. Did he have patience or faith? We see in verse 1, it tells us that Job is blameless and upright, and one who feared God and turned away from evil. Verse 2 tells us that he was very wealthy, and he had 7 sons, 3 daughters. He possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 female donkeys, and many servants. compared to today's wealth, Job would have been a multimillionaire, at least. I mean, with all that he had and all that he had. Job was the kind of guy that we would definitely want in our congregation today. He was upright. And he was a very, very good man. You know, we talked about last Sunday about being happy and what we need to do to enjoy what we have here, what the Lord has provided us, and we realize that if we truly want to enjoy what we have and our time here, that we need to please God. And it says in Hebrews 11:6, it says that without faith it is impossible to please Him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that He exists and that He rewards those seek Him. We've all heard someone say, well, that he or she has the patience of Job. And I'd heard that all my life, you know, when somebody could take time and deal with something that other people would get frustrated with. And if you ever put toys together for kids at Christmas, I'm telling you, you need the patience of Job, because it seemed like I always, we'd never start till after the kids would go to bed, and then I'm sitting there and Tanya was no help at all. She'd sit there on the couch and sleep while I tried to put the toys together. But some of the instructions, even then, I didn't think I needed them. You know, I've done a lot of mechanic work all my life. And how hard can it be to put a Barbie playhouse together? It's way more complicated than people think, I'll tell you that. We've always heard about, you know, having the patience of Job. When things don't go right and we get rattled, we see people that'll go through suffering and things and seem like they still are just, they have the patience and can just continue on. And a lot of times we don't. And if you want to try your patience, drive a tractor and trailer through Atlanta, Georgia. I mean, that will try your patience, I'm telling you, because y'all can't drive. Well, and maybe and the truck drivers can't either sometimes. So it can get very frustrating out there on the highway. It says, we read in James 5:10-11, it says, as an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remain steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. You know, I've heard Christians say that I need more patience. And they say, well, and then I've always been told, don't pray for patience because the Lord may try you and see how patient you are. And then most of us, when we want pay, we say, Lord, give me patience, but give it to me right now. You know, I don't want to wait. I want it right now. And we live in a world today that everything, we want it right now. We don't have time to wait. But yet, it seems like the more technical we get with all this stuff, and I don't know how your all's TV is, but we got Spectrum, you turn it on, and you wait and wait and wait. And in the old days, when you turned it on, you was hooked to the antenna, but you got TV right then. And by the time the TV comes on and loads sometimes, I thought, man, this is taking a long time for the technology that we have. Isaiah 40:31 says, but they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength, and they shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. It tells us in Job that there was a day when Satan was among those presenting themselves, and God said to Satan, from where have you come, Satan? Satan tells God, oh, I've been going to and fro on the earth, and walking up and down on it. And I couldn't help but when I was reading that, I got to thinking about when I was young. I just got my driver's license, and of course, a 16-year-old boy, and got a car. I bought me an old car, and we like to run around, you know, travel as much as we can. And I figured out real quick that Mom seen me heading out the door with my car keys. She said, David, where are you going? And I didn't always want to tell her, because she might not approve, she probably wouldn't approve of where I was going or who I was going to be with. So I got this, I started just telling her, and it worked, and I used it for a long time. I'd say, oh, I'm going across the hill. And we lived in a little town, in a little area, and no matter where you had to go, just about, before Highway 80, you had to go across what we called the Doing Mountain. And about anywhere you go to, you had to go across Doing Mountain to get to Hazard, to get to anywhere. So I told her that day, I said, oh, I'm just going across the hill. I got out the door and I got the car. I said, that worked. And I thought, well, that's pretty good. So then even when I come back in late or something, where have you been? Oh, I've just been across the hill. And I used that for many years. My sister, which is only 18 months younger than me, she tried the same tactic. It didn't work. No, Mom had to have an exact where she was going, what time she would be back, and who she would be with. And I don't know why it didn't work for her, but it did for me. And then I got to thinking about this as I was reading this in Job, you know, and God talks to Satan, and he asks him, you know, where you been? What you been doing? Apparently Satan had been across the hill. He went over to see who he could devour, and running up and down the earth. But it made me think about that. Now, I'm not comparing myself to Satan, but I did go across the hill. And, you know, Mom would let me by with it. And Satan would go after who he could find. And then God said to Satan, he said, have you considered my servant Job? There is none like him on earth. Then Satan said, God, you put a hedge around him and all of his house and all that he has. I can't touch him. You've got him protected to the point that I can't get to him. And he said, but if you would let me get to Job, let me go in and take what he has, he says that he will curse you. And God told him, he said, you can go after him. You can go after his property, his house, everything there, but you can't touch Job. And it says, then we see what Satan does. He destroys Job's property. He takes away his family. After losing all this, the Bible tells us that Job fell on the ground and worshiped. In all this, Job did not sin. I think about what Job lost in this first round with Satan, and it made me think how faithful would we be if God allowed Satan to take everything that we have, everything that we have and we own on this earth, even to the point that he took Job's family. Faithful would we be to God? Could we have the patience and the faith that Job had here to stand firm and stand with God? Then we see Satan, he does destroy everything. It says, you know, many times I've seen people that things like this will happen in their life, and the first thing they do is blame God, or they'll curse God. Something will go wrong, and maybe they'll lose something, or they'll lose a loved one, and they'll say, God, why did you let this happen? Job didn't do that. Job continued to have patience and have faith in the Heavenly Father. The second chapter goes on to tell us that Job held his integrity. But Satan says, skin for skin. If you let me attack his body, and he truly, God, he will curse you to your face. Then God said, go ahead. He's in your hands. Only you cannot take his life. Okay, Satan, go ahead. Go after him again. You've took all of his stuff here. You took his house, his children. You took all of his servants. All of his wealth you have took. Go ahead and attack him again. But you can't take his life. Then we see that Satan struck Job with sores from his head to his toes. Said that Job would sit in ashes with broken pottery and just scrape himself, the sores. You know, I guess just to try to relieve some of the pain that he was going through. Then he tells us that even Job's wife told him, curse God and die. you know, get this over with. You know, you have to be miserable. And even all this, Job did not sin with his lips. Then I think about Job's wife at this time. Not only did Job lose all he had here, but you know, Job's wife also lost all her children, all the wealth, everything that they had. So Job's wife would have to be suffering too. Even though Satan, don't tell us nowhere that Satan attacked her, but she had to be suffering too. She'd lost everything. And I think that Job's wife was angry with God. And I think that's why she told Job, just go ahead and curse God and die. She was also seeing her husband in agony, you know, in pain. Later in the book of Job, we see his friends come to him. And they sit with him. I think it says for like 7 days or something, they sit with him. But after a while, then they start deciding what Job needs to do. And then they start telling him things, you know. They tell him, Job, you need to admit what you have done wrong and repent, and God will bless you again. You know, sometimes those that come to comfort us in a time of need, they do just the exact opposite. Sometimes people come to us and they say, well, here's what you need to do. And that's not always the case. You know, we have friends that are hurting sometimes, and silence can be the best thing we can do. We need to go to them when they're mourning and mourn with them, but let them know that you're praying for them. Sometimes the last thing they need is your human advice of what they need to do when they're suffering through this time. Because we don't always know what people are going through. He goes on to tell us that God restored Job twice as much as he had before. There's a story that I've read. It said there's a story of a 4-year-old little boy whose next door neighbor was an elderly gentleman. He had recently lost his wife. Upon seeing the old man crying, the little boy went into the gentleman's yard and climbed into his lap, and he just sat there. When the little boy come back home, his mother asked him, she'd seen him over there with the old man, and she asked him, she said, what did you say to your neighbor? And the little boy said, I said nothing. I just helped him cry. Sometimes in our mourning, we don't need your advice. We just need you to help us cry. And we need you to pray for us as we go through these things. Sometimes just being there for others is an important thing. You know, when we're in need of prayers, we may not always need to know what you think, but we need to know that you prayed for us. Remember, we serve the same God that Job was serving, and God hasn't lost any of his power. He still protects us from Satan. But the question is, are we faithful to our God like Job? Then I got to thinking about, you know, what if, and I'm so thankful that he don't do this, but what if God's blessings and stuff that was poured out upon us was on the same scale as our worship and serving him is? And I thought about that, you know, and I said, you know, if he measured the same way that we do, we'd probably all only get to spend our time in heaven would probably be between 11 and 12 on Sunday. And, you know, if you think about that, that tires at my heart. Because a lot of times, it's almost like we forget God, except we're in his house. But our worship time should be 24/7. And then there should be a time of meeting with other like-minded Christians from the 11 to 12. That's where we need to get back to if we want to see our world get back to serving God the way they should. We've got to see Christians get back to serving God the way they should. We've got to see Christians be more like Job. No matter what we go through and what we lose, we need to get back to serving our Heavenly Father. We serve the same God that Job did. The definition of patience is the capacity to accept or tolerate delay, trouble, or suffering without getting angry or upset. That's a whole lot to understand patience. Romans 12:12 says, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, and be constant in prayer. To be constant in prayer, we must also have faith. The definition of faith is complete trust or confidence in someone or something. So the answer to this message about Job, was it patience or faith? The answer is yes. It's both of them. In order to have patience, you must have faith. Help us all to extend patience to others around us. By doing so, let us show them their faith in you. And you know, it's sad, but sometimes we can't tell the difference between a Christian and a lost person when somebody cuts us off, when somebody pulls in the parking spot that we had planned. And I'm going to pick on Tanya a little bit this morning. Her driving, her actions are, that's what she'll do. Every time somebody pulls in front of her, both hands.
It could be worse.
And I don't think she's saying, praise the Lord, they got this parking spot.
I'm so glad you got us.
We do need patience in what we do. And we should be able to tell the difference between the lost of our world and our Christians. Because if we don't, we're headed in the wrong direction. Because God wants the people to see His children. And that the world around us that is lost and dying and going to hell, they need to see that there is a difference. Because if they don't see a difference, they don't know what we got. And if we truly got it, there should be a difference. There's a song that says, "It is well with my soul." It was written by a successful Christian lawyer, Horatio Spafford. His only son died at age 4 in 1871. In 1872, the Great Chicago Fire wiped out his vast estate, made from a successful legal career. In 1873, he sent his wife and 4 daughters over to Europe on a summer trip on the ill-fated ship, the SS Vow. Since he had a lot of work to do, he planned to follow them later. The ship sank, and he lost his 4 daughters, with the wife being the only survivor. She sent him a famous telegram, which simply read, "Saved alone." On his return home, his law firm had burned down, and the insurance company refused to pay him. They said it was an act of God. He had no money to pay for his house and no work. He also lost his house. Then while sitting and thinking, what's happening to him, being a spiritual person, he wrote a song, "Whatever, my Lord, you have taught me to say, it is well with my soul." My dear friend, a good attitude will determine your altitude. When you look at your life, your career, your job, or family life, what do you say? Do you praise God? Do you blame the devil? A good attitude towards God makes Him move on your behalf. Just sit down and say, "Today, God, it is well with my soul. I am thankful I had a peaceful sleep. I am thankful I am alive with possibilities. I am thankful I have a roof over me. I am thankful I have a job. I am thankful that I have family and friends. Above all, I am thankful that I have you, Lord Jesus Christ, on my side." Be blessed, and don't be envious or shocked when others are prospering because you don't know what they have been through to get there. Tests, trials, and tribulation. So thank Him for what you have. Little is much when God is in it. It is well with my soul. Touch someone's life today with this message. If God is for us, who can be against us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, as we read about Job and the patience and the faith that he had. Lord, we pray that you will help us all this day to be stronger, not only in our patience, but especially in our faith this morning. Help us, Lord, to help others in our world. It's not about us. It's about you. And one of the things that you tell us, Lord, in your word, is to help our neighbor. We need to show patience and love for all those around us. Lord, I pray that you would just give us more faith this morning. And I thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand.
Attendeth my way when song.
Amen.
I had the farthest walk.
Yeah.
Oh, he did. Oh, my goodness.
Good to see you, buddy.